Good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee's sixth meeting of 2017. Our first item is the Limitation of Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill, and it's an evidence-taking session. I refer members to paper one, which is a note by the clerk, and paper two, which is a spice paper. And I'm particularly pleased to welcome our panel members for the first panel today. We have two panels, the first panel being Graeme Garrett, Solicitor, Association of Personally Injured Lawyers, David Whelan and Harry Aitken, both representing former boys and girls abused in Quarriers homes, Sandy Brindley, National Coordinator of Rape Crisis Scotland, and Laura Baxter, Operations Manager with Victim Support Scotland. So I think we'll move straight to questions, and if I could perhaps start with a kind of general question and stating the obvious, that the bill removes the three-year limitation period where the court action in question is about child abuse, with retrospective effect. So could we start maybe by asking the panel members to put on record their views about this proposed change and also what impact they think the new law would have on survivors? Anyone like to start?
Shall I start?
Absolutely, Mr. Whelan, thank you.
I'm a victim of abuse. There was a criminal conviction in my case, and then there was a civil case which was time barred. So the benefits of this bill, and we commend the Scottish Government for bringing this bill forward, and it has the support of the survivors. The benefits will be injustices of the past will be righted. It will enable us. There's an absurd position in Scotland where you have a criminal case and you have a criminal conviction, but actually when you go into the civil court process, that is actually time barred. And what has happened in these cases, and I just want to give you a little bit of personal background because I think it's important the committee really understand this, to have a view of what's actually happened in the past. Quarriers and their insurers and their legal teams have actually tried to usurp the criminal jury process by the tactics and antics that they've used in the civil processes. So what they've done is they've made people like myself go and see so-called false memory experts such as Dr. Janet Bolkes. And they've actually challenged the testimony I gave in a criminal court, which was actually upheld by a jury, which was actually upheld by an appeal court. And what they've done is they've further damaged it and harmed the victims in these cases by not actually addressing the original harm. So the law needs changing. The civil process is also antiquated, it's Victorian. Lady Smith made some comments in relation to my case about the issue of me not coming forward and why I didn't come forward. But can I just say, I was never asked to come forward or given evidence in the criminal court justice process to explain that delay. So that, to me, is a major fault in the civil court process. Because if I was able to go and actually personally speak about that delay, I am sure that would have been helpful to Lady Smith, who incidentally happens to be the chair of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry.
To start with, but definitely you feel there's the anomaly where in the criminal cases there is no time bar, but in the civil there is, and this bill would right that anomaly.
We believe it would do. The definition in the current time bar legislation is too narrow, and it's a bar to progressing cases through the civil courts, and the definition needs to be widened. It's clearly the insurers are a vested interest organisation. They will challenge what wants to be done here. But actually, justice needs to be done and delivered for the survivors.
Okay, thank you. Would someone else like to comment?
My organisation strongly supports the bill because we feel that for the past 50 years, victims of abuse have been denied a voice. They have seldom been in the position of being able to say in open court what happened to them. And that is because limitation has operated as a brick wall which they have come up against. This bill is not a panacea, because victims will still face a number of significant obstacles before they can be awarded compensation. But it is a very important step, we believe, in giving victims a voice.
Thank you, that's helpful. Mr. Aitken?
Yes, just to support something that David said. David and I have been on this journey together for 15 years. This is the first time I've ever exposed myself to the cameras. And because it is so important, I felt that today I had to come out into the open. I have a public face as well as a private face. And that public face I have tried at all times to defend and protect. But today, because of the importance and the significance of the dimension of access to justice for survivors, I wanted to come here and speak to you. So I support this bill. I support it on a number of grounds, primarily because at long last, after all our campaigning and our discussions with across the spectrum of cabinet ministers, MSPs, Scottish Human Rights Commission, CELSIS up at Strathclyde University, all of these agencies, we have spoken to them all about our fundamental requirement for survivors and the fundamental right of survivors, that is, access to justice. So many barriers have been placed in the path of survivors that it has been a diabolical disgrace to the people of Scotland. Their rights have been infringed. Every impediment has worked to the detriment of the survivors. It seems quite easy for a care provider to lodge a plea of time bar and then leave it to the courts to deal with, when the survivors themselves, the prejudice to the survivors under that situation is tantamount to further abuse. And David referred to Dr. Janet Boakes. She absolutely abused the people who had been in the court, had gone through all the child abuse, that she re-traumatized them, and it caused so much consternation in the minds of survivors and the community that very, very few of them have come forward since that time. However, we have 1,000 people, 1,000 survivors on the books of Cameron Fife, a Glasgow lawyer, who at that time were prepared to come forward when they thought there would be an opportunity for access to justice. But as soon as the legal aid provision was removed, that 1,000 people were abandoned. And so far as the time bar is concerned and the discretion of the judiciary, 40 years since 1973, not one case from a historical abuse situation in residence was the discretion of the judge invoked. Not one case. That was from 73 until 2013. Ladysmith presided over 8 cases lodged by former Quarriers residents. And in every case, they were refused the discretion. 4 of them had already been proven in the criminal court. They secured a conviction for the abuser, and still they were refused the discretion. It was only until 2013 when Lord Kincleaven saw the light. And he said, this is the time when the discretion must be invoked. That is my power. And he gave the opportunity to a case which is well known. It was an uncle versus a niece. And there was child abuse in the home. So that was a kinship care abuse situation, not a residential care situation. But Lord Kincleaven said, there is sufficient evidence from the criminal court to proceed with this case. But more than that, there will be no prejudice to the defendant. There was no prejudice to the defendants that we had to face in our cases. And yet, Lady Smith, she presided over these eight cases, and not one of them were allowed to proceed. So we recommend, we advise it, we recommend it, and we support it. And the impact it will have a dramatic impact on the lives of survivors, the thousands of survivors in this country who suffered the most terrible, horrific abuse, and they are still suffering that abuse to this day. It demonstrates itself much more evidently as we get older. Every person, as they grow older, loses resilience, they lose resource, and the effects of the trauma they suffered in childhood surfaces. And they've tried at all times to protect their families, protect their friends and relations, but ultimately it surfaces. And do you know what happens to them? They end up, in many cases, in hospital, the criminal justice system, in prison, and the worst of all is friends of ours who've suffered so badly, they take their own lives.
I just say that we are very, very pleased. It takes a lot of courage to come before a committee, to come into the public domain and give evidence. So can I say that at the outside? We very much appreciate all the panellists coming forward on that basis. If I could perhaps paraphrase a little bit, Mr. Aitken, then it's not a panacea, the bill, but it's certainly a major step in removing some of the barriers that you've very eloquently described in your testimony. And to go a little bit further, then you're probably saying while the discretion was there in the courts to remove the time bar, it hasn't been really used to anything like.
Never been invoked, not effect. Once in 40 okay. years.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Anyone else? Sandy?
The first thing I'd like to say is that I think it's to the credit of survivors who have had the bravery to fight for this change, and I think what justifiably is seen as an injustice and a barrier to justice. I think the nature of child sexual abuse or child abuse in general is that it can take people a long time to feel able to speak, so the time bar disproportionately affects child abuse survivors in a way that my organisation definitely sees is unjust. I think this bill is welcome. I echo the comments about it not being a panacea, but I think it will improve access to justice, and I think that is to be supported.
Thank you very much. And Ms. Baxter?
Hi. First of all, just we would also, Victims Watch Scotland warmly welcomes and supports the bill, and we know there's numerous reasons why victims of child abuse are unable to speak about it within the three-year time limit, and this, in fact, does give them the voice, allows them to be heard and recognised for what they've actually been through. I just met the gentleman here this morning, and I have to paraphrase what Sandy's saying, really very courageous to come forward and speak about things and the campaigning that they're doing. Very, very impressed with the work that they're doing as well. But we would warmly welcome this bill.
Thank you very much. Rona.
Yes, good morning, everyone. When the Scottish Government consulted on the impact of these proposals, some respondents said there could be a possible issue with the bill, and that would be that survivors would still have to revisit the traumatic events with lawyers and with the court system. Do you think that's a valid concern, and do you think the benefits outweigh the disadvantages for survivors, that they would have to sort of relive some very traumatic events?
Who'd like to do that, Mr. Whelan?
Survivors have already given that answer by publicly coming out, by publicly campaigning for the last 15 years for a change in the law. And actually, the survivors want this. The survivors who are able to come in front of you today, we're stronger than the other survivors. We're able to articulate what possibly the benefits will be to the bill and everything else. But we represent many vulnerable people and have done for many, many years, many more vulnerable than ourselves. And they've already spoken. They've spoken in the media. They've come out. They're speaking at the Child Abuse Inquiry. They spoke through the National Confidential Forum. The Quarriers victim survivor spoke through to Time to be Heard. So they're actually... It's false to say that people wouldn't come forward if there was a change in the law. People would take the full benefit of the change of that law.
Do you think that represents the majority of survivors?
I do. I definitely do. Mm. I definitely do.
The significance of it is that at long last they will have the choice. And this element of choice has been denied them until now. They are well aware, and we will make it aware to them, anyone that we speak to, and we speak to them quite frequently across the whole of the nation, sometimes in England and wherever they come from. The point about it is this. We, although they will already all have heard, that it will be a difficult task for them to go forward to the courts. They will have to have a robust case, it will be cross-examined, and it will have to stand up to the normal practices of the legal system. However, having made that choice themselves and having the courage to go forward, I believe that will fortify them and give them an opportunity in their lives to demonstrate that they saw it through to the end. They were not oppressed or suppressed by the system, which we all have been, from our childhood right through. And at long last, the Scottish Government has given them that opportunity. So the impact on survivors will be dramatic. It will be positive, and it will enlighten and enrich their spirit.
Thank you. That's very encouraging. Thank you.
Any other comments? Douglas, you wanted to come in with a...
Just a small supplementary on this, and I'm grateful to the evidence we've heard so far. And while I can understand that victims are prepared to give evidence, and some have done it in a criminal case before, is there a concern that with the vast numbers that could potentially come forward and our already stretched justice system, that not just giving evidence could be a barrier to some who don't want to give evidence, but actually when they see this bill, if it passes, they then get, you know, a peak. They think, this is great, I've now got an opportunity. But because of the numbers, there's a huge delay in some people actually getting their day in court. And how do you think survivors would deal with potential frustrations that they now have the opportunity to go to court, but because of the pressures of the court system, they're not getting their place in court immediately?
Could I come in there on the issue of vast numbers? Because, as I said in my opening comment, there are still a number of pretty serious obstacles facing anyone who wishes to seek compensation for historic abuse. The first is that many victims will have been abused not in institutions but by individuals. And you have to have someone who is worth suing before you can seek compensation. Foster carers are likely to be a particular difficulty. Of course, the age of many of these cases means that the evidence may simply not be there.
I think what I'm trying to get through with the cases that do come to court, they will be complex cases by their nature. They will take time to go through the process. And if you're in the first tranche, you will hopefully get the satisfaction of having your evidence presented in court and potentially the correct outcome. But if you are waiting for other cases to be heard before your own, I just wonder how survivors who have waited so long to get to this stage will face with the frustration of having to wait longer while cases and the justice system potentially struggles to deal with these any increasing cases. And that's what I'd like to hear.
I think it's scaremongering about the vast numbers about who's going to come forward. It's scaremongering by the insurance companies to stop the Scottish Government bringing this bill forward. It's just another tactic being used, because clearly we've said already that robust evidence will be required. It will need to be scrutinised. If there's a preliminary hearing on that case, it may not still process to proceed to the next process. But what we're saying is, in the issue for us is, you have to bring the victim forward to be able to give that testimony personally to the first hearing, and to explain if they're able to do that, to explain that. Now, about delays in the court system, with all due respect, that's not our issue. That is probably the committee's issue to deal with. On You know, the court should facilitate the process of justice, and it should do it in a proper and expedient manner.
I would like to just echo that point, but I think there are resource issues for the court service as a result of this bill, but I don't think that should be used as a reason not to improve access to justice. I think that's an issue for the government to consider if there are resource implications as a result of this bill.
Opportunity to move forward. That's been covered quite well. I'm going to move on to the next question, John. Stuart Stevenson.
It's a relatively small point that can be answered concisely. I just wanted to be clear that you're satisfied that where the victim themselves might not be able to act because they're intellectually disadvantaged, would be an example, there may be others, that this act will allow others to act on their behalf.
Yes, of course. I mean, clearly victims will have legal representation if the bill is enacted, and they'll be there to support them. But one of the things that...
I'm not making a legal point. I'm making a point that, you know, a carer for somebody who's been...
Yes,
abused,
of course. Whoever
it's that side of the equation.
Whoever the person nominates to represent them, the bill should still assist those cases.
I'm sorry, I'm going to be very precise. Yeah. Some people may not have the capability of making such a nomination. That's the point I'm getting at. And I'm not trying to open this up too much, just to make sure that when we talk about victims, we're not restricting to victims who have the ability to make all the decisions in their lives for themselves. And I'm just seeing if you're satisfied that we're covering that group.
Clearly, we would want every victim of child abuse who has a case to proceed, no matter what their disabilities are or incapacitated. You know, many survivors would have been within the mental health system because of what happened to them. And I think, again, it would be an indictment on the system if they were not allowed to be heard.
That's helpful. We've got that on the record, and that's what I wanted. Convener.
Probably, are we speaking about advocacy too? The person brings it, but someone is the advocate for them, you know, not in the legal sense, but necessarily, but someone who is able to maybe articulate their case better than the victim perhaps could.
Can I call you Margaret?
Yes, absolutely.
Margaret, I think that has been happening in the past cases where people have advocated. I think people like Sandy's organisation, Victim Support, have advocated for survivors in the past, and so that would continue as far as we would wish that to continue, because we're dealing with some of the most vulnerable people in society, who society has actually let down, and where the state has failed in their duty of care.
We've got a number of questions, so we'll move on unless it's particular.
Yeah. This is a practice that we have used for some years now, and also it's strengthening in Scotland because we've just established the Survivor Support Fund, and that is now has 26 partners, all with expertise in the different domains of trauma and requirements that survivors have. So there will be the opportunity across the spread in Scotland for people to have an advocate and for people to have support, which they already do, whether it's children's files, going to court, looking at meeting with any panel that they have to meet. And that has already happened. And that is embedded in the system now. And it works extremely well because we have very proficient and very sympathetic and understanding support workers who do that for us. So I don't see, the one thing that I would like to pick up on, I meant to say, Douglas, was that the first tranche, if it was really well organised, would be the frail, the infirm, and the elderly. And going through that process helps them. They may die happy. And sorry to be so blunt, but that's what we feel about it. And watching the outcome of these, that first tranche, then there might be an impetus, a further swell of others coming forward. But that is easily supported by the evidence from across the world, Australia, Ireland, and Canada. All this has happened, so we do have a good bank of information which will support us in understanding these processes. And I don't see any real problem if a person is at long last given the choice to make their own mind up whether they want to go for the court system or they want to wait until they get redress and take their case through that process. Because after all, we still have to deal with the 1964 issue, which may crop up in your questioning today. And we know survivors who are in their 70s, 80s, and 90s, still living today. And they will be, I hope, the first people to be exposed to that opportunity. So the methods that are in place, I think, will suffice. They will work well, as they have done up till now. And I see no impediment to them, these people getting access to the whatever means of support or outlet that they want.
Thank you. John?
Panel, and thanks for your evidence. You'll be aware that the bill enjoys a lot of support, and indeed I support it myself. But there are critics too. And if I could pick up on one of the points of criticism, I'd welcome your comment, and that is that were the bill to proceed, then the new regime would have cases decided on poor quality or limited evidence, and further, that new regime would draw what's seen as scant resources away from other areas. Could you comment on that, please?
The last bit would...
The resources that would be required to support this regime would be redirected from other valuable areas.
Can I deal with that one first, please? Yes, I do understand that, but there is evidence from across the world, and we have to look outside Scotland to see, because we have fallen behind, but we're catching up quickly, and 15 years is not a long time in the life of a survivor compared with the times that other people have had to wait in other jurisdictions. With regard to the paucity or the lack of evidence, that has been debunked in many cases where people have been able to come forward to the criminal courts and present their case. And on the basis of the evidence that is available, they have been able to be successful. Not in every case, because I do agree that it is very, very difficult. But if you take into account the kinds of obstacles that that we have to confront, the loss of children's files, the deliberate destruction of children's files, which Tom Shaw in his systemic review reported. All of these matters can be taken into account. However, sufficient evidence to support a robust case has been done in other jurisdictions, and we are happy to hear that. With regard to drawing resources away from other elements of society, that doesn't really bother us. It's not our concern, because we are all taxpayers. And also, isn't it time that the jurisdiction of Scotland shows and demonstrates what they really mean when they say that they will support survivors and the poor people of Scotland and the vulnerable people of Scotland? And these resources could be quite easily allocated to deal with it. And in regard to the numbers, we've come up with a figure, and this is the Scottish Government's figure, of 2,200 survivors coming forward. Only 10% of them will go forward to the courts, and that is taken from their own figures. So it's not a monumental task, it's an important task, and if we do believe in the rights of our people in this country, after all, the defenders' rights are very well protected with Article 6 and Article 1, of the convention, the rights of the individual in many cases across the years have been flaunted and been ignored. So if the Scottish Government are serious, then I'm sure they will find a way to support the system and get us through the process.
John, can I just about resources? Your streets are littered with the damage that's been done to the victims, and the resources that have to go into the NHS, the resources that have to go into the voluntary groups, the resources that have to go into other areas to address and actually repair the damage that's been done. And I think another amount of resource to actually finish that and ensure that justice is delivered, I think that is a resource well spent.
Thank you. It's important to address the critics, and it's helpful to get that on the record. Thank you.
Thank you. Mary?
Thank you, and good morning. One alternative approach to the bill, and it's been suggested by some of the opponents to the bill, would be to provide greater guidance, whether that is by statute or another means, to judges and how they should exercise their discretion under the 1973 Act. And Mr. Aitken, you've already commented on the judges' ability to use their discretion, and I don't know perhaps if you want to make any additional comments on that before the rest of the panel comment on what they think of that proposal.
Just to confirm what I said, that they were advised. They were always advised. They knew the substance of the bill. They knew the substance of the Act. They understood the discretionary powers. And don't forget, it comes in terms of unfettered full discretion. That's the language which is used. And they still didn't see it in their judgment to allow cases to proceed. In many cases, and I've read very, very carefully, the judgment made by Lady Smith in particular with the Quarriers case. In some cases, I'm a layperson, I would have seen and did see the opportunity for Lady Smith to invoke her powers. She didn't do that. And that's not to get at Lady Smith. She just happened to be the person who presided over these cases. So that is not something that I think will bother us in the future. Simply because the robustness of the system, the way it's defined by the Scottish Government right now, is you have to have a case, and it has to have the evidence, and it has to be robust, and it will be tested in court. So if the limitation element is removed, so also the strength of the court case system will predicate on the effectiveness of that survivor's case going further.
Can I just come in on that? My understanding is the bill will widen the awareness test and will, in a sense, where the judiciary have been very conservative in as Harry says, one case in all those years, that demonstrates that it's a... and the judiciary have to take responsibility for the judgments they have passed down in these cases, and they can't just pretend that they're somewhere up there and they don't exist and they're not accountable to the people, but they are accountable to the people. So our understanding is that the awareness test will be widened in the legislation, which should enable the judiciary to not have an excuse to time bar a case, and it will be widened to the effect what child abuse is, what effects are, et cetera, et cetera. So I think the definition being widened should support the judiciary to actually make the right decisions the second time round.
Thank you. Anyone else like to comment?
Another benefit to legislating rather than relying on discretion is that it gives greater certainty to survivors about what the legislative framework is and what their options are. I don't think that the evidence tells us we can rely on approach based on discretion. I absolutely think we need to legislate in this area and give greater certainty to survivors in these really difficult circumstances.
Didn't give survivors any confidence.
I don't think it would give any certainty about what the approach is likely to be, and I can completely understand that survivors, based on past experience, would not have confidence in that approach just because it has been used so infrequently. I mean, in fairness, I think, to the judiciary, it's a completely different legislative framework that we're now talking about, and I think that is the right approach to take.
Okay, thank you.
You certainly need certainty. Mm-hmm. It needs to be clear. The law needs to be clear because clearly it's unclear. I think one of the Lords said there's a mischief in the legislation that needs to be addressed. I can't remember exactly who said that, but that's clearly what needs to be addressed here.
Okay. And further to that, could I add that with regard to the opportunities which the survivors can avail themselves of, and this awareness test, it's proposed by the Scottish Government in the bill that the awareness will be looser in its interpretation. And I think that is something so important because Celsus, Strathclyde University, have found, and through the research, that it's 22 years, the average of 22 years before a survivor discloses their abuse. It's longer for men than it is for women. But the point about it is this: if that was allowed and there was much more flexibility in the court system under this new proposal, then the awareness of their knowledge of abuse and what their rights were could be dealt with. And the other element is this: they also recommend that other factors be added, and an exhaustive list of factors will be considered in the case of a survivor coming forward. For example, I can give you two which I remember during consultation. One was, what did the care home or the management do when cases of child abuse were reported? What did they do? What protections did they put in place? What investigations did they undertake? And what actions did they take if anything was proven? That's the first one. The second one is, as a child leaves care homes and leaves the care system, they have a right to be informed of their rights. And it's been suggested by survivors that these rights extend to any possibility of complaints they may have of their care system experience. And that is dramatic. That is the first time. It's a radical approach. And I believe that would be, that would then place the incumbents and the onus on the care system of Scotland to protect our youngsters after they leave care. So that one also would help. So the bill is shaping up to have a lot of great things in it for survivors, which will help them in every dimension of their lives.
Thank you. I think that, you know, the rights of the defenders, they will still have the right to challenge every single case, and we recognise that right. And this bill is not going to remove that right. But what we recognise is you challenge it, properly challenge it, not try and discredit the victims, not try and undermine the testimonies that were given in criminal courts. If you want to place a challenge, we recognise that challenge. You have that right to place that challenge, but it should be done properly.
Okay, thank you. Ben?
Convener, good morning all. The Scots civil law, the notions of limitation and prescription stand alongside each other. And obviously the focus today is about access to justice for survivors, and the new proposed regime for limitation is about enhancing that. In terms of the related area of prescription, the Scottish Government has decided not to reform this, deeming it that it's unable to do so, or it would be inappropriate to do so, because that would create a breach of the European Convention of Human Rights. The effect of this decision is that the abuse occurred prior to September 1964, usually will not be abuse where it will be possible to raise a court action under the new regime. I just wanted to get thoughts from the panelists on that, and whether you think the Scottish Government's decision on prescription was appropriate.
Previously, from my understanding is, and I'm a lay person, but I want. Can I just place on record, I want to thank Eleanor J. Russell, who did the research into these historical abuse cases, which I was able to submit to the committee, and I want to thank her. Clearly, we would like every case to be enabled to go forward, but we do recognise the difficulties in the 1964, and we recognise that through the Scottish Human Rights Interaction which we undertook over 18 months with the government and all the other parties. And we were actually in discussions with the Scottish government, as are other survivor groups and other parties, about the commencing of a discussion around redress. And we particularly have focused that on initially the pre-1964, because we recognise that the law may not be able to be changed as much as we would like it to be changed for every single survivor. We recognise that there is an issue around the SHRC, European rights thing, so the law may not be able to be changed. And in fairness to the government, they've actually explained that to us in clear terms. Again, I want to thank the Scottish Government because in the last 2 years, they've taken the time out, ministers have taken the time out of their brief to meet with the survivors and meet with groups and meet with individuals of survivors. And actually, they've actually taken the time to, I believe, understand what the issues are that we've been facing. And they have brought forward a number of the elements of the interaction review group now. And there's still some elements outstanding. But the pre-1964, we recognise as a survivor group, it's difficult for us, but we would want to every single survivor to be enabled to this law to be helpful. But we recognise that the government has explained that to us. We recognise their position, and we also fully support that they're engaging with us on the interaction review group and on the interaction plan, on other elements that will address that particular issue.
Can I chip in, Ben? Yes, we do understand this problem. It's a dilemma for us, but I think it has been resolved in our minds for the people I have spoken to, and looking at me, you can tell I'm not 35, but the people we deal with, we are able to talk them through it as best we can. It's a long negative prescription problem, but it's substantive law, whereas limitation is a procedural law. We do understand that. And in this case, when the 1964 law has to be enacted, there is a reconciliation in the minds of many, many survivors, not all, but in many, many survivors, that it's a closed door for them. It's a difficult pill to swallow, but at least we do understand that. But further, there is a proposal that the best way to deal with that then is to make sure that they are treated fairly and appropriately in the redress scheme once that is up and running. And I think if that is done sensitively and to the proper degree, I think that would satisfy the people who may not be with us very long. At least they will see recognition. And the 1964 dilemma, they'll take that to the grave with them.
My organisation fully understands the reasons for the 64 cut-off date. We feel that the class of case which this is likely to catch is the very class of case which would have struggled on evidential grounds anyway to establish a successful case. I can also look at the criminal injuries scheme, which, for entirely coincidental reasons, also operates a 1964 cut-off date. I sat as a tribunal judge on criminal injuries cases for 10 years, and I think I can say that during that time, I came across one or two cases at most which were caught by the 1964 rule. So I don't believe we're talking about significant numbers.
Okay, thank you. That's reassuring, and it's also reassuring to know from survivor groups that there is an understanding about the so one of our fears in this committee was the potential for the bill to raise expectations where there wasn't access to justice through this new legislation. So that's reassuring that there's a wide understanding among survivors around the balance.
Those conversations, and they've been open and transparent, and they've been supportive of what the survivors wish to achieve within the interaction plan. Where there's been difficulties, I believe the government to date has explained those difficulties and taken the time to explain those difficulties.
Thank you.
I could maybe just follow up on that. I think you're saying there's a realistic expectation of what is possible and what isn't, and that, you know, the difficulties arising from pre-1964 are there. But the fact that there would be some redress, maybe some recognition for these people that this abuse had taken place. I wonder if you'll be aware there's an Apology Act. Would that help, the fact that it's been acknowledged and there's a commitment to look into the circumstances to ensure it doesn't happen again?
within the interaction plan, there's a number of elements, and apology law was one. There was a redress. There was the National Confidential Forum. There was the public inquiry. So there was a number of elements within the interaction plan that was agreed. I think the apology law is certainly very, very helpful. And I think it's actually going to be helpful to the pre-60 poor, but it's also going to be helpful to those who will be helped by this law as well, because it will allow there may be some people come forward actually and go to the civil process if this bill is enacted, but actually all they might want is an apology. And actually the organisations will be able to give that apology without the fear of liability. Now, I didn't kind of support it initially, as Margaret knows, because of the liability bit within the apology law. But we recognise fully that you need to enable organisations to be able to give that apology without the fear of liability. And I think with redress and apology, it's up to the individual survivor what they want. But some survivors may want all three, some survivors may just want one element. But certainly, an apology which is sincere and meaningful is probably one of the most powerful things you can give someone as an individual, no matter the hurt and damage that's happened.
I think also the fact it has the provision to look into the circumstances to see if there's anything to ensure that it doesn't happen to anyone else, which I know is a huge issue for survivors.
I think one of the drivers for the survivor groups is we want to ensure that the next generation of children cared for in Scotland are actually, that the organisations are actually fit for purpose. And that is one of the drivers for us. You know, this cannot happen to another generation of children cared for in Scotland. And of course, we can't prevent every single case, but if the systems are robust, if the systems are investigated, such as through the child abuse inquiry, then at the end of it, we would expect institutions to be fit for purpose.
Mr. Aitken.
About 6 years ago, a visiting professor came from Australia, and this lady had dealt extensively with the apology law in Australia. You may have seen her. And I was present at that discussion, and it really allayed many of the fears that we had, simply because it gave the abused agency, for want of a better word, that the freedom to express themselves to the survivors and give an apology. So that was one good thing. That was a human thing, and that worked extremely well. But she also said, in the process, claims were accepted more readily. Less claims came forward on the basis of controversy. They were clear. There was a pathway made clear because the apology had been made. And the other thing I'd like to add was an attempt was made during the Time to Be Heard Pilot Forum under Tom Shaw, Kathleen Marshall, and Anne Carpenter's aegis, when at the end of the process, the survivors were asked, by the way, we have this method called restorative justice. Would you like to take part? They were at their most vulnerable. Some of them said, justice, yes, that's what I'm after. So they were given this restorative justice method to pursue. 15 opted to take it out of 98. 9 continued. And to my recollection, to my knowledge, only one successfully completed the course, simply because the apology was meaningless, it was given in the wrong context, it was not given by the right people in the right circumstances, it was not ratified, and it was not supported. That was a disgrace to the survivors. And I tell you, the people that we had to support through that process were traumatized yet again. But this method, and I say thank you to you, Margaret, for your sterling work in getting it through the system. This approach has the stamp of authority, has permission, and has the stamp of efficacy attached to it. And I do believe that it will remove the burden from care providers, that no longer will the insurers, the mighty and powerful insurers, stifle them and constrain them so that they will now be able to make an apology. And also, it removes another impediment. There's no excuse now, because they are allowed to give an apology without liability. So I can see the merits of it.
I think it was Professor Provine you were thinking about.
That's right. Yes. I just want to say one thing about restorative justice, because I think it's important to say this. This isn't actually a model that would suit survivors, and I think it's demonstrated what Harry said about the there was only one outcome. And secondly, the reason some of these past processes have been criticised or have failed is simply this. They didn't consult with us. They actually put it there and said, you're going to be part of this. Whereas the difference in the last 2 to 3 years is we have been consulted on the processes that directly affect us, and we've been able to input into those processes that directly affect us. So that is the way forward. The processes need to be victim-survivor-centred, and I recognise the law and the legislation may be different, but it is there to support the survivors, or it should be enabled to support the survivors' access to justice.
Thank you. Mary?
It was just really to hear from each of you about the terms child and abuse that are defined in the bill. For example, when we look at abuse, do you think that, I mean, there has been some criticism about the definition or lack of within the bill around that, but do you think that abuse is defined with sufficient precision that survivors can feel confident that their case will fall within the scope of the new regime?
Certainly, our positions that we support as broad a definition as possible. I think it's very welcome that the definition of abuse has been broadened to the initial terms, which was in care. I think it should cover any form of abuse, and certainly from the work that we do, I think it needs to cover all sexual offences. My understanding is that it is sufficiently broad at the moment. I think the difficulty is as soon as you start being more specific that you're potentially then going to limit people's experience, and as panel members have already said, I think what we want is for this legislation to be able to be accessed by as wide a range of people as possible. So we're content with the wording as it stands just now.
There is one slight hiccup in what has been said before. The mental, the physical, and the sexual abuse is well catered for. There is another form of abuse which emanates from the church environment, and they've always, the survivors have always said to us, and we put this forward on their behalf, that spiritual abuse should also have been included. Because it is a different dimension. It's something that gets somewhere else in the human being and has to be dealt with. And the other three don't really deal with it. However, it's probably more damaging because it's in the soul, in the heart, in the mind of the person. And I would have liked to have seen that continue, because we did used to have it on or consultation documents, but that has, it has been removed. I'd like to see it included once again.
People were indoctrinated, you know, they were indoctrinated in these institutions in relation to religion. And, you know, the damage that is done to people is quite extraordinary. You know, on the one hand, you are being abused by someone who is potentially a faith person, a priest, or someone else who has a religious connection, and you're being abused, and all of that mixed in, the damage is just unbelievable, and to indoctrinate children into the Bible in an institution and abuse them at the same time, what does that actually do to that person as an adult? And you can see the damage, and the, you know, there's mental health issues, there's alcoholism, there's 40% of former residents who've been in the care system within the criminal justice system. All of these issues are about issues, and they're not all relating to the care system, but there's certainly an impact of how people were previously not cared for properly.
Was there a supplementary?
Just to clarify that, do you think that's something that should have a specific mention within the bill, or do you think that the definition as it stands at the moment would be broad enough to encapsulate that specific time?
See it broad enough for the reasons I've given, simply because if we go back to the section 19A and section 17 in the Limitation Act, discretion may come into play. And we don't want any discretion, because with discretion comes confusion. And we've seen in the cases of Lady Smith that I'm not saying she was confused, but she certainly didn't use her discretion to our advantage. So I would like it to be there just for the sake of clarity and certainty, such that the people who did suffer this kind of abuse, and not all of us did, would not be neglected or forgotten, or even abandoned for that matter. And it brings together all of the elements of our society in that it's not just the police, it's not just the social services, it's not just the care providers, it's the church. And the church is the foundation of our society, and we don't want them to escape that scrutiny, which the bill should hopefully allow us to do.
Please vote, and then Liam.
Thank you, Convener, and can I firstly say thanks to the panel and what powerful evidence we've heard today. A supplementary from Mary's point, can I wear my hat as convener of the cross-party group on racial equality, and following on from the discussion we've just had, do you think that the bill and the definitions are broad enough to incorporate the challenges that many members of ethnic minorities might face when presented with these challenges?
Sandy said, I know, I support what Sandy said in relation to the definition and the widening, the elements that are contained within the bill. Every bill should recognise every individual in society. It doesn't matter their creed, their religion, or their colour. So one would hope that we're legislating for every individual in society.
I could just add that there's no evidence in the bill as it's presented that there will be exclusion, and that is comforting. So if we take it there's no exclusion, that means everyone is included. And inclusion across the spectrum of all types of creeds and genders and whatever, you will have the opportunity to allow them to avail themselves of the benefits of the law. And I think as it stands, this bill will certainly support them in that endeavour, simply because we cannot, at this late stage, having gone through this whole process and ultimately attempting to right the wrongs of the past, make a mistake, such a simple mistake such as that. And I don't see any evidence that that could happen from the way I read the bill.
Okay, I think it was important to get that on record. Thank you.
Liam, was that supplementary?
On this, and can I join others in thanking you for the clarity of your evidence this morning. The point you make about spiritual abuse, and I think you set it out very clearly, but going back to what was being said earlier, Mr. Whelan, I think you were talking about the quality of the engagement that you've had with Scottish Government at ministerial level and official level. Has there been an explanation as to why they were reluctant to take that particular point on board? It's something obviously we can raise with the Minister in due course. I'd be interested to know what explanation you've been given for why that wasn't encapsulated within the definition of abuse.
Quite honestly, we didn't ask that question. We discussed it within a survivor group, and I think Harry may have raised it, but we didn't specifically, so it'd be unfair of me to say that we asked the Scottish Government specifically about that. But we did ask about the definitions within the bill, and we were satisfied by the definitions in the bill that they were as wide as could be at this point in time. Clearly, if they can be wider, then we would welcome that.
We can follow that up.
There is a particular section of our society who are in a minority, who feel the impact of spiritual abuse more than others. And we did discuss it. It was discussed at the consultations, and I saw it in some of the literature.
but it never has been, it never filtered its way through to the bill. So I'm really putting a case forward for that minority. It's a substantial minority. I'm really putting a case forward that they should also, and their view and their fear should also be represented in the bill. And I think it would be to the detriment if we didn't do that.
The government will be following the evidence this morning, but we can follow that up in due course. Thank you.
It does mention emotional, so do you feel emotional doesn't cover that particular?
No, because we all feel emotion, and we start with feelings, we start with emotions, we start with thoughts, and then we move to actions. And that's the way the human species operate. But emotion, we all feel that emotion. Different scales of it, different levels, different formats and different expressions. But no, this is something I'm trying as a layperson to explain, that it's something that is so fundamental to a human being. It's not just an item of experience. It's something that gets right into their bones and their soul. And if we overlook that part, I think that will be to the detriment of this group I've just identified as being a very substantial group in the community.
If we could probe a little further, then I think it's often been said, show me the child of seven. And if you're looking at things from a religious point of view, I suppose there's almost a moral code. So it's almost been as though that's been tampered with in some way. Is that the kind of thing you're trying to get at, that emotion wouldn't cover, but perhaps spiritual would?
Clearly we wouldn't want to. What I'm trying to say, Margaret, it's not one institution, so we wouldn't want to define it as a particular institution. Again, it's about equality and it's recognising what that issue is, and it doesn't matter what the institution is, what the label on the institution is, whether it be Catholic or Protestant or whatever. It's not about that. It's about that specific abuse type.
Thank you. That's been very helpful. I think we've covered all the supplementary now and your substantive question, Liam.
Just turning to the issue.
Liam? Yes, it was, sir, I think.
I think we've had a discussion previously about rights of discretion. I know that's why I'm slightly thrown. Do you want me to continue?
Could I go to where we should go? Absolutely. I don't want to throw you. Stuart, it should be you.
Thank you very much. I want to explore some of the way in which the insertion of 17.6 and what it actually says. And I particularly address my questions to Graeme Garrett. So this is the technical kind of stuff we as a committee get involved in, less about the underlying policies, but whether the words in the bill implement the policies we're looking for. And in particular, you have some concerns, I think, about the way in which this section is drafted, particularly in relation to the relationship between the amount that was paid out in a previous case and the expenses. And I just want to make sure that you have the opportunity to put that in the record and for me to test it as well.
Thank you for that. Yes, our concern is that if the intention of the bill, which it clearly is to permit people who have brought actions previously to be entitled to bring fresh actions, it seems to us that the provision is going to eliminate a large group of these people at source. And that is simply because we fail to understand the rationale for saying that someone who may have received what really would have been a trivial payment many years ago should be prevented from bringing a claim for full and proper compensation now. This is not a matter which, as far as we can see, was rehearsed in the consultation document. We're not sure where it's come from. And as I say, we simply don't understand the rationale behind it. If the intention is to avoid double compensation, then this provision goes very far beyond that. It would be relatively simple to say that anything which has been received as compensation in a previous action should be offset against any damages which are obtained in future. But that is not what the bill says. And this is likely to have very damaging consequences for the very group of people who did in the past attempt to do something about the abuse. And that seems to us to be an extremely unfair situation.
I take it really the issue you've got is with 17C4B3, which reads, any sum of money which it required the defendant to pay to the pursuer,
which follows on and
indeed. I confess as a committee member to being puzzled as to where that might come from and exactly what cases it's trying to allow to progress and which it's trying to stop. Have you any insight? I'm not sure I understand from what anything the government said.
This came as a great surprise to us when we looked at the draft bill. We simply couldn't see the rationale for it. We couldn't see what evil it was trying to correct. And in fact, it seems to us to create an entirely new evil in that people who may have received what they regarded at the time as being quite insulting levels of compensation will now be met with yet another brick wall, which will prevent them from pursuing a claim for full compensation. And that seems to us to be entirely wrong.
I suspect it simply is confirming in my mind that this is a matter we need to raise with the government when they appear in front of us. I'll come to you shortly. If I may, I want to just finish one particular point. In referring to the previous payout being offset against any new payout, have you a proposal as to how the previous payout, which might have been made two decades earlier, should be valued when deciding what the sum of money that should be offset against the new payout should be? Because clearly, if it was a very small payout, that will magnify, if nothing is done, and will magnify the size of the payout they would now get. But if, on the other hand, you index link it forward to today, it will reduce it. Have you a view as to what properly should be done?
I think it could simply be offset as a straight arithmetical deduction. When the court is doing an interest calculation, which it would have to do, what it would do is to credit interest on the earlier payment, which would be offset against any, and the earlier payment together with accumulated interest would then be offset against the fresh damages. That seems to me to be a perfectly workable system.
And the government, the courts would use the standard discount yes. rate that yes. applies in these circumstances.
Well, the discount rate would only apply to future benefits, to future damages. It wouldn't apply to past damages.
Yeah, but there is a discount rate could be used from the point of. Let's not get too. We'll ask the government. I think is basically what it boils down to. And Mr. Whelan, you obviously had a point. I'm trying to pursue quite a technical point.
No problem. I know that we part of our campaign for the bill was that the cases that had been tried in the criminal courts and that had been time barred in the civil courts, we wanted them reheard, and that is a definite as part of our campaign. So in other words, that where it's been time barred previously, then because basically what they've done in the civil courts is, and I didn't. It's a Latin terminology. I'm not sure I can even say it, absolutum. It means that you can't bring the case back into the court. I'll be quite honest, I didn't understand that at the time. But as I've said to the committee in my correspondence, legal aid was withdrawn at the time. I wrote to the Court of Session saying and put on record, I asked for my letters to be put onto my file, that should the law ever change, that I reserved the right to bring a future case forward. And I think it is really important that these cases that have been time-barred in the past are given a proper opportunity. And I do specifically put on record where there's been a criminal conviction, that those cases should never have been time-barred. And what's happened, and I don't want to labour on this point, but actually the defenders and the organisations, including Quarriers, by their actions, have actually made this whole process very adversarial. If they had taken a different approach in the early days, I don't believe that the processes would have become as adversarial as they became. And they were very adversarial around 2003 to 2007 within and Quarriers have to take some responsibility for that. They have to take responsibility for the actions of their insurers, the actions of their solicitors in the civil court processes, because the harm and the damage that they have done to people, including myself, is enormous.
Can I just intervene? I suspect this is what Liam wants to develop with you, looking at what he's going to be asking. And my point was quite a narrow technical point about 17C, which is about the civil cases without reference to criminality. Would that be reasonable if I hand it to...
Sorry, could I comment on your specific point?
Yeah.
We can take an example. The Dumfries and Galloway Monkland home gave ex gratia payments to all of their residents to the tune of £20,000. Now, that was a sum which was compensation for any or all abuse that was covered, that they were subjected to. And we felt that that was one size fitting all. There was no gradation of the abuse that people had suffered. So in that case, some people may say, well, my abuse was fairly slight. I've gained £20,000. I now come forward to, under the new bill, and I've got the possibility of compensation again. That's one possibility. Take the other possibility. Someone who was severely abused and badly damaged, £20,000, come forward, and the £20,000 becomes the factor that you manipulate in order to see that fairness was being done. So I don't think that that should be included. If you want to count it back, using discount rates, net present values, then that is something that could be done. But it must not be to the detriment of survivors. It must be wholeheartedly in the spirit of the thing, the severity of the abuse, the gradation of the abuse, the duration of the abuse, and all other matters that are relevant before that decision was made.
Did we cover the onus, who it would be, whether it would be the pursuer or the defender who had to prove to the court the details of the settlement? I think you'd made the point that wasn't clear in the bill.
It's not at all clear. And I think there are two issues here. One is a point of principle, and that I would suggest is the main issue. Is it fair that people, because of this clause, should end up receiving less than full compensation? And I would suggest that it's not. Allied to that, there are a number of practical difficulties which are going to face claimants and indeed insurers in actually working out what happened in a previous litigation. As we say in our paper, solicitor files may no longer exist. Insurance records may be scanty. The most court actions are settled by a document called a joint minute, which does not actually set out the settlement terms. Claimants may have been very young, and the claim may have been settled on their behalf by parents or by social work departments. So they may be completely unaware of the settlement terms. Now, these are all, if this clause remains in the bill, these are serious practical difficulties going forward for claimants. And if it's to remain, then we feel that some guidance needs to be given as to where the onus lies. Is it on the claimant to prove that he did not receive a payment, or is it on the compensator to prove that he did? And it may seem a narrow issue, but we suggest it's an important one.
Oliver, on that point.
I just wonder whether, I mean, I don't have enough legal knowledge to know if it is the sort of answer to it, and we'll obviously ask the Scottish Government in due course. But I do wonder when you start to talk about previous settlements and other things where, you know, there already is a terms and, you know, some facts have already been established in order to get to that situation. If there isn't a difficulty around having a fair trial the second time, if some of the issues have already been decided and thought about, and if that's why this is cropped back in.
Bear in mind that you will very rarely have had a trial dealing with the facts of the abuse. These cases, by definition, will have been dismissed on a procedural debate because of limitation. And so the facts were never actually aired. These cases proceeded on the basis of written averments by each side.
Uh-huh. But some of the facts will have been agreed within the legal parameters that existed at the time. Is that correct or not?
I don't, with respect, think it is, no. Okay, I don't think there will have been agreement. The second category is where, by agreement between the parties, the case was settled. And I think the same difficulties will arise in actually evidencing the terms of any such agreement, given that we may be going back 20 or 30 years.
Liam?
Thank you very much indeed. We talked earlier about the issue of discretion and the importance for survivors around confidence or certainty about the process. Obviously, the legislation affords the court discretion in terms of dismissing cases in two circumstances where it would not be possible for a fair hearing to take place and where, in relation to retrospective application, there'd be significant prejudice. Now, there's not a great deal of detail around that. I think we're led to believe that some of that will only flow through future case law. Where is this? I think there's been unanimity across the panel up until now. Rape Crisis Scotland and yourself, Mr. Garrett, haven't really offered a view on those two provisions. I think Victim Support said it was a reasonable position, but Mr. Whelan, you've expressed some concern that it really be appropriate for all cases to be given a fair hearing on the facts and the evidence. So I'd be interested to know where the panel stand in relation to these provisions, bearing in mind that there isn't the tight definition around how these two provisions would apply.
I can be very brief on that point. My organisation recognises that these checks and balances are probably necessary. Whether they're in the bill or not, as a matter of law, these are issues which a court would have to apply anyway because of the human rights legislation. And so even if the bill were silent on these, the position would be much the same.
Are you able to almost predict the way in which they would be applied because of the way that they've applied elsewhere in law?
Yes, I don't think that these are novel concepts for judges, and I think judges by and large are pretty good at dealing with these on a case-by-case basis.
And back to the point that was being made before about the problem with the discretion to date in terms of not applying the time bar, would there be a concern that this discretion may be used in a way that could almost reintroduce the time bar provision, but perhaps not to the same extent?
I think perhaps not to the same extent. I mean, I think anyone who has looked at this over the years would be forced to conclude that the Scottish judiciary is an extremely conservative body, and that it has operated the discretionary power in a way which has simply closed the door, in a way which has not happened south of the border. There is a legitimate fear that these provisions may simply transfer the discretionary power to a later stage of the case, but it would certainly be our hope that by getting rid of limitation, the damage which can be done by these would be greatly reduced, if not eliminated.
Mr. Whelan, does that bear out your concerns?
Again, I'm not a legal person, but we would want the discretion to be as wide as possible and the provisions to be as wide as possible so that there's no element of doubt and where there's clear certainty in the bill and clear, in a sense, the legislation is clearly directing legally what the judges are able to do without any element of doubt. That's in layman's terms, that's what we would like to see.
Okay.
Thank you. You're right. It's not something that we picked up on in our written submission, but we have been contacted by survivors expressing concern about how this might operate in practice, particularly for certain religious institutions, and whether or not it might restrict the benefits of the legislation. I think it is very difficult to predict when it's going to be dependent on case law. We don't know how this is going to be interpreted. The government, I haven't seen any clarity from them about how they anticipate it's going to be interpreted. So I think it does introduce some uncertainty about how this legislation might be implemented.
Is there anything that could be done in terms of the legislation or ministerial statements around the passage of this legislation that might provide additional clarity?
You could simply remove this and say that every victim of historic abuse will be entitled to have a hearing in court. I'm not convinced that that would necessarily be in the interests of all victims of abuse, because if a case were so weak that it was almost bound to fail because of lack of evidence anyway, then I'm not sure that that would be of assistance to every victim.
I think that, unless Ms. Baxter, did you have any view on that particular from, you know, the survivor?
I think we'd said originally in our submission that it was reasonable to put this in, not having a legal background or having the full knowledge of what that actually means. But I think if it was clear and concise, and backing up what my colleagues here say, clear and concise and leaving no doubt what it actually means, and whatever what happened, it wasn't to the detriment of the victim.
But just to be aware that that could be a stumbling block was probably good to raise, so that it didn't come as a shock or an impediment maybe later on, because obviously you want the bill to be as effective as it possibly can be. That concludes our questioning for the panel. Can I thank you all for attending, and can I thank Mr. Whelan and Mr. Aitken particularly. I realise just what a huge amount of courage it is to come and talk to a committee, but please be assured that it's been so worthwhile from the community's point of view. I hope you feel the effort has been worth it too. We'll now suspend to allow for a change of panel.
The committee for taking forward this bill and for scrutinising it and for allowing us today to come to give evidence. And in relation to, I've gave the committee some personal documents in relation to my court case and other issues. If there's anything I've said today that you need further clarification, I'm more than happy to provide other information in relation to Dr. Janet Bokes and other issues that we've raised today with the committee.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. We suspend now to allow for a change of witnesses. I now welcome our second panel on the bill, Alastair Ross, Assistant Director and Head of Public Policy with the Association of British Insurers, and Graeme Watson, member of the subgroup on Historic Abuse Forum of Insurance Lawyers. You're both very welcome. I think we'll move straight to questions, and if I could start with a first general one, much the same as we started with the last panel, in terms that the bill removes a three-year limitation period where the court action in question is about childhood abuse, with retrospective effect. And so would you like to place on record your views about the proposed change and also what impact you think it would have on organisations defending claims and on their insurers?
Yes, if I maybe start with that. First of all, we recognise from the outset what a sensitive and difficult this area this is, particularly for the victims and survivors to come forward in any forum, to come before you this morning, to seek out legal advice and to come before a court. We recognise that that is an exceptionally difficult thing for them to do, and that each case has to be considered on its merits. There are two particular aspects to this. The first is the policy, and the second then is the practice. The policy of the government is to access, to widen access to justice for victims and survivors. And we certainly welcome that as a policy. What I hope that I can do, what FOIL can do, in responding to this committee is talk through some of the practical effects of the drafting as it currently stands and what the impact of that might be. Two particular aspects that I would like to draw out of the drafting as it currently stands. The first is how this bill would deal with cases of historic abuse which have already been concluded. Those fall into two categories. Those where the case was dismissed, which means that procedurally it was disposed of, but the right remains and the action can be re-raised at any point. This bill would allow those to be raised again, as they could anyway, and would change the criteria by which the court would decide whether the claim ought to succeed. The second is those where there has been final decree absolvitor, that is, a final substantive judgment. And those cases have been determined by way of a final binding decree. It's interesting, I see that the committee has already written to the government to ask for their views on the pre-1964 cases and why those were not included within the scope of this bill. And really at the heart of the government's response to that is a concern that in those cases the substantive right has been extinguished and therefore there were risks of falling foul of the European Convention on Human Rights.
There, we're getting quite far down the line and into detail when my initial question is just, the bill is before you, it's a limitation bill, it's a three-year period. What are your views on that initially?
My views are that removal of the three-year limitation period and reinstating those cases which have previously been disposed of is problematic, that what we are replacing the Section 19A discretion with is a test of whether a fair hearing is impossible and are substituting one form of discretion for another. And I therefore have concerns about how much this bill is going to achieve in opening the door for claimants and what clarity there is around how those cases will be dealt with. You heard the concerns for certainty. I don't believe that the bill as drafted brings the certainty that the survivors and victims are looking for.
can perhaps tease that out a little bit. But the second part of my question was what impact you think it would have on organisations defending the claims and on their insurers.
Those fall into a number of categories. There are some who are insured, and so ultimately it will be a financial cost that insurers bear. There are organisations who may have been insured at the time but can't trace it, or who had very low limits of indemnity. That is, after some damages have been paid out in any given year, their insurance will be exhausted. There will be others who had no insurance at all for this sort of claim and will be meeting it directly and personally themselves.
Okay. And Mr. Ross, do you have anything to add?
Thank you, Convener. I think if I could start just by echoing Graeme's comments that this is an incredibly sensitive issue. It's most sensitive, obviously, for the victims and the survivors, and it's absolutely correct that they should be at the heart of this legislation. It's also probably the most sensitive type of claim that insurers will deal with, you know, compared to all the other types of personal injury claim and other claims that they handle. And insurers recognise that. Over time, insurers developed practices and protocols to specifically recognise the distinctions in this class of case and to handle them differently. And our members have put a lot of work into that. I mean, in terms of the proposals as set out in the bill, you know, we've expressed in our written evidence the concerns that we have about that, some significant concerns about the implications that it may have. I think where I would concur with the previous panel was on the recognition that the system as it currently stands is not working. You know, we have a central issue here which seems to be this application of discretion. As I say, the previous panel set it out. What I would draw the committee's attention to is that in England and Wales, judges seem to be more inclined to use discretion. Now, it's a different piece of legislation, but it's broadly similar in terms of what it sets out. And there does seem to be an issue that judges in England and Wales are more inclined to exercise discretion in cases where Scottish judges are not. That seems to be the nub of the issue. What I would ask is whether this bill is the best, the most effective way to address that and meet the needs of victims and survivors, when we would propose that there are more effective ways we can do that, or the committee can recommend that there are more effective ways to do that. Whether that be in providing additional guidance to judges, whether that be looking at some of the criteria under which discretion can be exercised, or the opportunity of bringing forward a different way to resolve these claims. I mean, we mentioned in our written submission the idea of a pre-action protocol, which would be a process that sits outside of the court, but would still be legally binding and has a number of advantages for all parties, not just for victims and survivors, but for all parties. I mean, I think it was Rona Mackay had mentioned this concept of secondary trauma, where if you accept that the primary trauma is the abuse being experienced, the secondary trauma is coming to terms with that as an adult, perhaps discussing that with friends and family, then going to a lawyer and discussing the details with them, then that lawyer sharing those details with other parties, possibly the alleged abuser as well, perhaps going as far as court and details being read out in court, even as far as actually having to stand up and retell your story of abuse. You know, all that is incredibly significant. And ask a lot of the victims and survivors that are taking this forward. A pre-action protocol could still achieve, depending on the way the protocol was drafted, a legally binding settlement. It would probably deliver that earlier or quicker than you would if you'd gone through the court system, where you may be subject to a number of delays for various different reasons. There would be an option, again, depending on how the protocol is drafted, that victims and survivors or pursuers could opt to move out of the pre-action protocol process and into court if that's what they were looking for. But, I mean, if you look at organisations like Bernardo's, who are a leader in this field in terms of supporting survivors and victims, and they've done a lot of interesting work, and I've talked to them about this, on the issue of secondary trauma. And we certainly encourage the committee to look at that and explore that. So we have significant concerns about the bill and its implications for insurers. I mean, the interest of insurers here is the organisations that have insured and the significant financial exposure that they could face if this bill is taken forward as is currently drafted.
I suppose you would hear the evidence earlier, and it came loud and clear that the survivors thought, A, it gave certainty, and B, it gave choice. Choice that, you know, didn't come from a pre-action protocol or having to go through that mechanism. It was quite clear that the time bar would be removed and they would have that choice. So,
if we just think about that in the context of what happens when any claim of any form is intimated, someone will write to the organisation, the person bringing the claim and the person defending it are likely both to appoint solicitors, and there will be an exchange of correspondence between them. In many cases, putting this particular area to one side for the moment, in many cases that will result in an agreed form of settlement and will dispose of the matter entirely. The point about a pre-action protocol is that it is a form of standardised way of doing that, so that both parties exchange what their position is, and if it is possible to reach an agreement without the necessity for litigation, they do that. If this bill goes through and the victims and survivors are hopeful that that will be a means by which they are heard in court, then that's not going to be any more the case than it is for other forms of litigation. Our job in acting as lawyers to insurers is not to defend claims which ought not to be defended. On the contrary, part of our role is precisely to advise them when claims ought to be recognised and settled without the need for a court hearing.
A supplementary, Liam?
Yeah, just on that, you will have heard in the exchange with the previous panel the fact that there is under 17D discretion for cases not to be heard, where a fair hearing couldn't be guaranteed, and where, given the retrospective nature of the application of this, there could be significant prejudice. I think there was some concern expressed that this may, in a sense, be used in the same way as the courts have to now use their discretion in relation to the time bar, in a way that would effectively lead to the time bar being applied, albeit maybe not as rigorously in future cases. Is that, given what you've said, Alastair, about the approach of judges north of the border and south of the border, would it be reasonable to assume that perhaps their approach to that area of discretion may lead to survivors not having an opportunity to have their cases heard?
That's an interesting point. I think the important thing to keep in mind in all this is that we have a balanced and fair process. And I appreciate the reasons that have been put forward, the arguments that have been put forward for changing the limitation period. But I think we also need to keep in mind the need to deliver a fair trial if the case goes to the trial, and the need for equality for all parties involved in this process.
But in terms of that issue of confidence and certainty about the process, I mean, again, you will have heard the concerns around the way in which the discretion that the courts currently have has just not been exercised at all, and the time bar in all but one case has been applied. I mean, it's not impossible to imagine the use of those two circumstances where cases wouldn't be heard being used in a similar way to apply the time bar almost by the back door, so to speak. Is that something that you think is a realistic prospect?
I think an important point to bear in mind about limitation or time bar, you know, the two terms are interchangeable, is it is a legitimate defence. There may be occasions, and again, it was touched on in the earlier session, that, you know, cases might go so far back in time that there might no longer be an abuser, an alleged abuser, that you could actually pursue. There might no longer be evidence, whether it's records or whether it's testimony of other people that were there and may have witnessed abuse. The organisation itself that had the duty of responsibility may no longer exist. So there are a lot of questions and issues that brings up. I mean, I think as I said earlier, there is an issue that judges aren't applying discretion in the same way north of the border as they do south of the border. One option there is to provide greater advice. I don't know. I've not been able to find a record of the advice that's currently provided to the courts in terms of the application of limitation and the discretion surrounding that. That would be another route that the government could have chosen to have gone down this road and explored that. I don't see any indication of this in the bill and the supporting documents. And so I would say that there are other options here, and I think, you know, it would be useful for the committee to explore this in the round. Just to come back, if I may, convener, to a question that you'd raised from the previous session about survivors saying that the bill offers choices to pursuers. I mean, I absolutely appreciate that. What I would say is that a pre-action protocol could be an additional choice that might be preferable for some groups of victims and survivors. I mean, in the time I've been working on this and dealing in this area, I've come to appreciate this is an incredibly complex field, and it's an incredibly complex group of victims and survivors with different interests and different priorities and different expectations. And I don't think any one process would meet them all. I mean, the previous panel touched on some of that in terms of what people are expecting at the end of this. You know, does the removal of time bar mean that your case proceeds? No. I mean, other witnesses already set out that there are other factors to be taken into account. You could say arguably that the removal of time bar would provide for a day in court, but that might not mean that the case actually proceeds for various other reasons, including quality of evidence or the existence of other parties. So I think it's important to bear in mind the choice of pursuers. And it would be interesting to hear, you know, I mean, the likes of the written evidence from the former boys and girls abused at Quarriers homes had suggested that they would be open to some kind of solution outside of the court or some kind of protocol outside of the court. So it would be interesting to explore that as well. But I absolutely agree and appreciate the importance of choice for the pursuers. But return to the point I made that, you know, we have to have a fair and balanced litigation process where the needs of all parties are observed.
John Finney.
No, morning panel. Before I come on to the substantive question, Mr. Watson, you said something very interesting about your role as a lawyer and that how you would offer, you suggest recommending a settlement. Are you able to say how often you've done that? And perhaps, Mr. Ross, maybe as head of policy, you'd be able to give statistics, say for the last 25 years, how often that has been the case?
Not often. I've been acting in abuse cases for 17 years or so, and over that time there have been very few of those that have progressed. I would say that in recent years it has been a larger number that have been settled, but equally it's also fair to say that in recent years there has been a lower volume of cases that have been brought forward. If we were to go back 15 years or so, then there were high volumes of cases which were brought forward. And as Mr. Whelan set out himself, when legal aid was withdrawn for those cases, many of them ceased at that point. But where cases have been pursued on the merits, then there are certainly some, but it's a low number, that have been settled on that basis.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to talk about time again, and that is that for criminal prosecutions it's not subject to time bar at all, and this can lead to the situation where you have a successful criminal prosecution but there isn't the facility to follow that up with civil action. That's surely not an equitable situation.
What's striking about the criminal position is that there is by definition an accused who is fit to stand trial and does stand trial. I agree that the discretion would seem to be working in an obtuse way if there was sufficient evidence for a criminal trial to proceed, but not for a civil trial. And that then comes to what criteria you use to determine whether there is sufficient evidence to proceed, how a discretion is exercised. But this bill doesn't simply cover those situations where there is a live accused who is available to give evidence, whose evidence can be heard, and can be tested in court against the other available evidence.
Specific example, you have a historic case that results in a criminal prosecution. And we could talk, but I don't think we should necessarily, about the degrees of proof required, criminal versus civil. That's an inequitable situation, surely.
Well, the situation that Mr. Aitken mentioned of the case of an uncle and his niece is a case in point for that, where the discretion was exercised in favour of allowing the case to proceed, where it would otherwise have been out of time, precisely because the evidence was available. And I agree with you. I agree that the discretion, or whatever is in place, ought to deal with that situation. However, the bill as framed covers the whole spectrum of cases where abuse is alleged. And that will include cases where there is no criminal prosecution. And even if there were, in the circumstances where there is a lack of witness or documentary evidence. And that's why it's important that there is a means of weighing up, a means for the court to weigh up whether an action ought to proceed or not, precisely so that clear circumstances, such as you set out, can be dealt with equitably by allowing it to continue, and cases where there is a dearth of evidence are not taken to a full hearing.
Only by testing in court that you establish whether there's a sufficiency.
Well, that's a good point, and that is a question that arises from the drafting of this bill as well. And a question which arises from that is whether it's better to test all of the evidence and then at the end of that have the possibility that the court will say, having heard all of the evidence, that a fair trial is not possible, or to have the opportunity of the court at an earlier stage determining that there is not sufficient evidence for there to be a fair trial, and therefore there would be no proceeding to a full hearing. There was a recent case where that precisely was the issue, and having heard a preliminary trial on whether there was sufficient evidence, the judge determined that the equitable discretion should not be exercised in favour of allowing the action to continue, but also stated in terms that a fair trial was not possible. Now, one element which may arise from this is that in those circumstances there would have had to have been a full trial, which would be necessarily stressful for all of those involved, particularly for survivors and victims, but to have the outcome that a judge says a fair trial is not possible. I'm not sure that's a step forward.
I take in good faith the comments you've made about your concerns about victims and survivors, but your obligation is to companies, organisations, and this may well be seen, your position on all of this is simply about finance.
It would be naive to say that insurers have no financial interest in this. Of course they do. But the interest is of their insureds, companies, organisations which continue to exist, and what their continued ability is to function. It is to ensure that while survivors and victims have the opportunity to be heard, that likewise those organisations who are facing allegations have the opportunity and the scope to put forward a reasoned response to that. And I think it was very well said by Mr. Garrett that even if the reference to the possibility of a fair hearing taking place wasn't in this bill, that would be the case anyway because of the European Convention on Human Rights. Limitation has a purpose of itself. It serves use to all those involved in knowing the limits of what their involvement in litigation may be. It was described earlier as a barrier, and I don't accept that. It is a hurdle, but it is not a barrier, and it is an equitable discretion. And accordingly, a risk which arises from this is pushing back the point at which the court decides on similar criteria to a later stage in the proceedings.
If I can come in there, Mr. Finney, just to concur with what Graeme said, but specifically in terms of insurers and their interests in this, insurance is a commercial contract. Now, in this case, it's to indemnify an organisation for some legal liabilities that may arise under the terms of the policy, and those can be very specific or they can be a lot broader. To be absolutely clear, for the avoidance of doubt, an abuser retains personal and primary responsibility for their acts. Now, insurers are providing insurance to organisations to cover certain liabilities that they may be obliged to deliver to third parties. Insurance is about managing risk. You know, so you pay a sum in terms of your insurance premium, and that manages the risk of claiming in that. The alternative would be to reserve significant amounts of funds so that if you did have a case raised against you in terms of abuse or some other kind of personal injury, you would have the money there to defend yourself and to pay for any compensation that was due. So it's a way of managing risk and a device to do that. Now, that helps us organisations to manage liabilities they might not otherwise be able to meet. Either it ties up a significant amount of money in an account just in case somebody comes after them, or they don't do that and they receive significant litigation and they have to meet that from current reserves, or actually puts the existence of the organisation in some doubt if they can't actually pay their funds. Now, what we're talking about here is public liability policies in the main, principally public liability policies, and they can cover compensation claims by victims and survivors of child abuse. I'll be guided by Graeme here, but in terms of the extended no-fault vicarious liability principle. Now, so what that means is even if an organisation isn't aware that it employs or has a volunteer who is an abuser, and even if they're not aware that that abuse is going on, there is still cover provided for the organisation under the terms of the insurance policy, if that's the case. That is what our interest is here, and it's in terms of working with our insureds, you know, our customers who have taken out insurance and entered into a contract. In cases where this is going back a significant number of years, whether it may be decades or into the last century or whatever, you're looking at a contract that was entered into by all the parties. At the end of that contract, it was closed, and you're now talking about revisiting that, you know, several years after the event, in some cases several decades after the event.
Thank you very much indeed.
Miriam, is a small point?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to be clear. We've had a fairly lengthy discussion around discretion, and I would like your view on whether you think the guidance that's given to judges is sufficient as it is to allow them to use that discretion properly, or do you share the view that some have that new guidance should be issued to judges and courts?
There is no guidance as such. And that's where the Scottish legislation differs principally from the English legislation. And it was interesting in the government's response at consultation stage, with the emphasis that they placed on the way in which this seems to work in England and Wales, and it seems to have greater difficulties in Scotland. So certainly one way of proceeding would be to have an equitable discretion with a non-exhaustive list of factors that the judges have to take into account. There's nothing like that in Scotland. All there is past case law, and the high point of that really is a decision of the House of Lords, which states that the court has to consider whether there is a real possibility of substantial prejudice. Now, I suspect it's not controversial that where there's a real risk of substantial prejudice, a court should be slow in considering that that action should be allowed to continue. But we're talking about one form of words as against another form of words. It may well assist the courts and the judiciary in general if they were to have a list of factors which they were required to take into account when considering how to exercise their discretion. And again, the bringing in the question of whether there can be a fair hearing does not provide certainty. It is another form of question for the court on whether an action has a sufficient basis to allow it to proceed.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, as I touched on earlier, I have looked into this and I've done research, and there doesn't seem to be any guidance afforded to judges on this. Personally, I find that quite surprising, but that seems to be the situation. It would be an option to look at providing more detailed guidance and, you know, putting in some of the conditions that Graeme's alluded to. Whether that's a role for Scottish ministers or whether that's a role for the Scottish Civil Justice Council, I'll kind of defer to others. I'm not sure who would have the responsibility for that. But that's one alternative to the actions that are proposed in the bill. I mean, we haven't had discussions with Scottish ministers about this. I mean, I know certainly the previous panel was a lot of reference to that. We've not had discussions with Scottish ministers about this, so I'm not able to understand why, reading the bill and reading the supporting documents, that's not been considered as an option, and Scottish ministers have opted to go straight to removal of time bar as their solution to what I think everyone agrees is a problem.
Okay, thanks.
Perhaps it gives certainty, and then sufficiency of evidence can be looked at when the case comes to court, if it does come to court or is considered. But there's the certainty it's being considered. Under your proposal, that certainty isn't there. It may be improved, but it's not there.
I don't quite follow in terms of
the time bar's removed, so there's no legal obligation. The court doesn't have to issue its discretion. So that certainty wouldn't be there, even with the improved improvements you're suggesting with guidance. Isn't that the key difference?
Yeah, I can accept that point. Sorry, I was confusing that with another point. I beg your pardon.
Okay, Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you. Really a question for Alastair Ross. You've got a number of issues with the financial memorandum, and think some of the numbers the government is using are perhaps not the ones you would suggest. It would be useful if we perhaps could get some of that in the record, and perhaps then explore some of that.
Of course. I mean, I think it's very important that we all look at the financial memorandum, because we're dealing with, by definition, for the reasons that have been set out, a fairly limited set of data here. I had some difficulties following the process by which Scottish Government arrived at the figure of 2,200 cases they anticipated coming forward. I may have misheard the previous panel, but I think there was a suggestion at one point that of this 2,200, only a percentage might come forward. That's not how I've read and understood the financial memorandum. But you know, setting that aside, you've got a financial memorandum that estimates 2,200. You've got Police Scotland saying they have 5,000 active cases that they are working on. You've got one law firm, or one lawyer in particular, that was mentioned earlier, who has 1,000 cases. It's very, very difficult to establish the quantum here. It would be useful to see some kind of independent analysis, whether that can be provided by actuaries or another independent group that could go away and do some estimating. The reason I mention actuaries is they might have access to data held by insurers that they could use on an anonymised basis. To try and extrapolate out some of the range of numbers. But bearing in mind the restrictions I mentioned in terms of the available data, 2,200, I think, is a figure that should be tested a wee bit more so that we can understand whether that's a midpoint, as the financial memorandum says, whether it's an overestimate, whether it's a substantial underestimate, and then that helps us to understand some of the other material in the financial memorandum, whether that's around implications for legal aid, potential implications for public sector organisations that may be pursued subsequently as a result of the bill being passed as drafted. It would be useful to see some more work on that. I know that the Finance and Constitution Committee considers the financial memorandum specifically and reports into this committee, so it would be useful to see their views on that as well. Is that useful, or is there anything you'd like to expand upon?
I suspect that merely expanded the uncertainty rather than closing it down. But in particular, are you of the view that the 5,000 cases that the police are pursuing are ones which would be time-barred? Because I imagine the 2,200 that the Scottish Government is talking about is ones that come back in to have a process and have a future, whereas the 5,000 is something entirely different altogether.
I can't recall offhand what the Police Scotland submission said. You've maybe got it in front of you there in relation to these 5,000 cases. I think from memory that was 5,000 active inquiries, and that was ones dating back as far as 1964. So, you know, time bar would possibly apply, but there would be more recent cases that they're dealing with where time bar wouldn't be an issue under the 3 year.
I suppose the other thing to which you may not have the answer, has the insurance industry itself taken a position as to what the liabilities for the industry might turn out to be?
It's incredibly difficult to put numbers in any kind of figure for that, because obviously different firms...
I'm simply asking if you've made a provision. Now, of course, you're representing the industry, and the provision would be in individual insurers, but I'm simply asking if a provision has been made. Not necessarily what the quantum might be.
I'm not aware of what measures individual member companies would have taken in terms of provision against this at this point in time.
Okay.
Ben?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I wanted to pick up on something that Graeme Watson made brief reference to in your opening remarks. As you hinted towards, the new limitation regime would sit alongside the prescription in this area of law. And as you're aware and alluded to, the Scottish Government has decided not to reform the law of prescription because it wouldn't be able to or appropriate to in terms of the European Convention of Human Rights. For clarity, the effect of this decision is that if the abuse occurred prior to September 1964, usually it would not be possible to raise a court action under the new proposed regime in the legislation that we're looking at around limitation. Was the Scottish Government correct to take this approach to prescription? Do you have any thoughts around that?
Yeah, the government was correct to take that position, and they were correct for the reasons that they set out. There's a difference between prescription, which extinguishes a right entirely, and limitation, which is a procedural issue of whether someone can exercise or enforce that right. It is a long time since Parliament took the view that prescription was simply not appropriate in personal injury actions at all. 1984, the change to the law came into effect, and no doubt that was right and appropriate that actions for personal injury should be subject to limitation rather than prescription. But the effect of prescription was that the substantive right was extinguished, no longer exists, and the government's concern is that it would run counter to Article 1, Protocol 1 of the European Convention if they were now to resurrect those rights. And I would say that the same arises for cases where there has been final judgment already. That's a very, very similar position, where there has been a substantive right which has been extinguished rather than a right which simply has not been exercised.
Mr. Ross, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, I don't think there's anything I would particularly add to what Graeme said there. I mean, it's one thing that does strike me is, and I read with interest the correspondence from the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, where she wrote to the committee in the papers for this meeting and noted that on the one hand, the Scottish Government doesn't feel able to address the prescription issue on grounds of European Convention of Human Rights, but does feel able to proceed in terms of the removal of the time bar and limitation. And she does recognise in terms of, you know, things like resurrected cases, this was a highly unusual step. And I just was struck by the kind of contrast between prescription and the application of ECHR and limitation, where it's felt that it's fair and reasonable and legal to proceed on that basis.
And of course, the clarity has been given in this session and the one beforehand. The difference is the one is an aspect of procedural and the other is an aspect of substantial Scots law. But that is good to have that on the record. Thank you.
Was one of the aspects there not the time, that prescription that tends to go much further, and also the legal rights would be extinguished. Therefore, is it fair so much later to look at reinstating them or possibly reinstating them. Was that not the issue that was at stake?
The question of extinguishing of the rights was certainly at stake. It's undoubtedly the case, and I think Mr. Garrett made reference to this, that when one gets to 1964, inevitably there is going to be a more difficult question of a sufficiency of evidence. But of course, there's not a light bulb moment come 1965. There's a spectrum. We could be asking the courts now to look at cases which time barred in 2016 relating to events in 2013. Not terribly difficult, perhaps, for the court to look back 4 years rather than three, but we would equally be asking courts to look at events in 1965. Again, in the circumstances, for some cases, it might not be terribly difficult to piece back together what happened. But in some cases, it will be. Documentary evidence degrades and is lost over time. Witnesses become unavailable, dead or untraceable. And so the challenges increase. And that's precisely why it's beneficial to have some form of discretion. Now, this bill does allow that to the extent that there's a question of whether a fair hearing can take place. That, in turn, of course, cuts against the possibility of there being certainty.
Really, the terms of Article 1, the right to peaceful enjoyment of possessions, you know, the further back it goes, the more that perhaps comes into play. Was that not more the factor that distinguished it from the limitation time bar?
That's of relevance to cases which have been disposed of by final judgment rather than to the pre-1964 cases. For it can arise in relation to both, but in different ways. If you have cases where there has already been final judgment, then the European Court on Human Rights has said that holding a judgment, even if it is that you're not liable for something, is something that has a proprietary value, and therefore interfering with that can be contrary to Article 1, Protocol 1. But you're right in that the further back one goes and looks to try to assess whether someone ought to be liable for events of a long time ago, the greater is the argument that you are not exercising proportionality in interfering with that.
If we could, Liam, briefly.
Talked about the challenges the further you go back, and I think everybody's accepted that. But similarly, I think all the evidence suggests that one of the real incongruities with the time bar, the limitations in relation to child abuse, is how long it takes for that abuse to be, in a sense, revealed by the individual, either to themselves and their immediate family, far less to the authorities, and therefore. The drive behind lifting the limitations in this respect is borne by the evidence that suggests, and I think that we were told that it's estimated around 22 years is the average for this to reveal itself. Do you not accept that that absolutely needs to be addressed because it's not being addressed through the discretion exercise that are available to the courts?
Absolutely, I'd agree with that entirely. And that's, again, where we come back to the fact that we are acting on behalf of organisations who are being held vicariously liable for the acts of a volunteer or an employee. And if events are coming to their attention for the first time 22 or more years after the event, they may simply have a dearth of material on which to proceed. Now, that doesn't mean that there should not be an opportunity for the victim and survivor to come forward and try to make their case, but it does mean that there has to be a balancing act in considering whether there can be justice done in the circumstances, which is a reason for having some form of judicial discretion rather than a firm cut-off.
Mary.
It's really just to give you the same question that I asked the previous panel in terms of the definitions of child and abuse that are in the bill, because I understand from your written submissions that you were critical of the fact that the definition of abuse wasn't exhaustive. So it was just really to see, to get your opinions on what amendments you would like to see from that and to get your opinions on that.
So far as the definition of child is concerned, I think there are reasonable arguments as to whether it is 16 or 18. 16 is the age of majority, but we don't take particular issue with it being 18. That's understandable. The issue with the definition of abuse is twofold. One is that it is currently framed as being non-exhaustive, and the second is what is encompassed within emotional abuse. When the government published its draft bill, it was sexual, physical, emotional abuse, and unacceptable practices. I think and neglect as well. And so the consultation referred to unacceptable practices. On reflection, the government took that out, and then in the draft bill had neglect, but has taken that out. And that's a recognition that there is a range of activity which it is harder to define and where it is more helpful to have a degree of clarity. On your specific question of what changes to the drafting I would like to see, the straightforward one would be to change the words includes to means, so that the definition reads abuse means sexual, physical and emotional abuse. Emotional abuse itself is not a well-defined term. It is quite straightforward to go to past case law and see what is meant by sexual or physical abuse, much less so with emotional abuse, and I think you had a flavour of that from the discussion with Mr. Whelan and Mr. Aitken regarding spiritual abuse and what is encompassed within that. So I would certainly encourage the committee to consider replacing the word includes with means, but also to consider whether greater clarity can be brought to what is meant by emotional abuse.
Yeah, I would echo what Graeme said there. The ABI supports the definition of a child as is set out in the bill. I would accept that. And similar to as Graeme has set out, we would propose that includes is replaced by means to give that tighter definition. I mean, the previous panel, I think it was Mr. Aitken, spoke about the awareness effect and how that brings forward potentially, you know, a significant number of people. What would be really useful is clarity in terms of the definition of what the bill is actually referring to, because we already had an interesting conversation about the concept of spiritual abuse, which wasn't one that certainly I had previously considered in looking at this bill. So that was very interesting. But the broader and the looser the definition, the more scope there is, and you would have an issue potentially, as I think Mr. Ross had touched on, in terms of volumes of cases coming forward. Now, that's not to say that the bill shouldn't go ahead just because it might create more business for the courts, but you're going to have to make sure that that can be met within the resources. It's not an argument against proceeding, but if the definition is significantly broad, then, you know, I think it's fair and reasonable to say that it's likely to encourage more cases to come forward. And then you're into a situation where I think we need to all ask questions about whether the interests of victims and survivors are being met. I mean, as I understand it, the bill as drafted is going to give, I think as the convener touched on earlier, the certainty of the case coming to trial. I don't necessarily know that it gives the certainty. Well, sorry, it gives the certainty of a day in court. I don't think that necessarily correlates into the certainty of the case going to trial, because we could still have, you know, some of the issues we've touched on before about availability of defenders, about the calibre of evidence. I just wonder how victims and survivors would feel if they're in a position where, because there was a broad definition in the face of the bill, and they were encouraged by whatever means to bring cases forward, whether that's by representative groups, whether that's by the lawyers, whether that's by claims management companies. One point I would make, if I can digress slightly, is I would hope that we don't end up in a similar situation on historic abuse cases that we do in other classes of personal injury, where you have this phenomenon of people being cold called, you know, an approach from out of the blue. The most common one would be in terms of whiplash claims. You get a phone call. I got one the other night. You were involved in an accident, in a car accident in the last 3 years. And I said, well, definitively, no, I wasn't. No, no, you were. You were. And, you know, we can help you claim for that. I would sincerely hope that we don't see similar practices in terms of this class of personal injury, but you will probably see organisations approaching people who have been in some of the institutions we've mentioned earlier around the same time as other people and being asked, you know, either were you affected by abuse or were you a witness to abuse, and how people will feel maybe decades on being asked to go and either give evidence as a pursuer or possibly give evidence of a witness of something they would rather not be involved in. Which slightly digresses off the point, but I think it's really important to get the definitions of abuse right. Hence, we would support what Graeme set out there in terms of amending it from saying includes to saying means, just to give that greater level of clarity and certainty.
Okay. Perhaps by way of reassurance, we also heard just how long it can take survivors to come forward. So I don't know if there's really a parallel to a whiplash, which is something people are quite happy to disclose or to think about, to disclosing something like that.
That was
so
my point.
Perhaps that was an unfortunate analogy.
No, and that was my point entirely. I would hope that the way that organisations handle the pursuit of claims like that would be entirely different to how they might approach historic abuse cases.
I think maybe what wasn't mentioned when you were talking about, you know, the volume going through the court and where that would come from is, fundamentally, this is looked at as an access to justice issue, and what the legislation does, as far as the witnesses seem to suggest, was make sure that the abusers were, those who were abused were no longer facing that substantial barrier, and awareness was raised that was the case.
Yeah, I would accept that, but I would repeat the point that the system is not functioning as it should at the moment. I think there's general consensus between this panel and the last panel that that's the case and action needs to be taken. Now, there's differences in views in terms of the action that you would take to resolve that, but I think there's definitely an issue with access to justice. I mean, I think in the previous panel, insurers were accused of having a vested interest. I would say we've all got a vested interest in making sure that victims and survivors can actually come forward and avail themselves of access to justice, but that access to justice must also be provided for the other parties.
A separate issue from looking at the substantive legislation.
Yeah.
Okay, Rona.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Mr. Watson, in your opening remarks, you talked about your concerns about Section 17C, and you spoke of your preference for a pre-action protocol, etc. I wonder if I could drill down a wee bit further into that. If you could maybe just give your key concerns surrounding that, given that you heard the evidence from survivors who are you know, very much in favour of re-raising a time-barred action.
The concern around that is that we are there dealing with cases which have previously been concluded by final judgment. That is a determination that their right of action has been concluded. And I would draw the parallel with the pre-1964 cases where the government recognises that a right of action has been extinguished, and accordingly the government's concern that it would run counter to the ECHR if those cases were to proceed. And what I'm saying is that those cases where there is final judgment by way of absolvitor are in the same category.
I don't quite understand how they're in the same category. I'm having difficulty with that one, given that, you know, time-barred cases after, you know, 1964 is a different issue from the prescription issue. Does it not give victims access to justice?
It does, and that's in the context of where they have already brought a case and that case has a final judgment of the court in it. There is a weight and importance to be given to the rule of law and the certainty of law. Part of the right to a fair trial is the right to have the determination of that court enforced. If we were looking at another jurisdiction where there had been a determination of the court and the government intervened to reverse the judgment of the court, we would rightly be concerned about that. And I recognise the government's concern about that so far as the pre-1964 cases is concerned and a right being extinguished. The same point arises for those cases where there is decree of absolvitor. To be clear, there are two types of cases. There are those which were disposed of by dismissal, which explicitly recognises the case can be brought again at any point. But there are then those where there was a final judgment absolvitor where the right has been determined.
I think just to add to that, if I may, what we're talking about is some significant principles under Scots law. And I know, I understand that you're going to be hearing separately at a future date from the legal fraternity in terms of the Faculty of Advocates and others. And I would certainly endorse what they've said in the written evidence to you. You know, we are actually talking about some substantial changes here. Now, I appreciate what we are talking about is entirely within the context of historic child abuse. But if you start changing these principles, is there a point at which, whether it's the Scottish Government or it's APL or it's another group, could come forward and say, well, the changes that you've made that apply to historic child abuse should also apply in another area? I mean, I appreciate, Convener, this is not the core business and interest of this particular session. But, you know, you're dealing with some fairly fundamental principles of Scots law here. And, you know, obviously the committee will consider it very carefully in terms of the proposed changes that the government's putting forward.
You'll also be aware that it's a very specific circumstance that the government is talking about removing the decree of absolvitor. And that was where there wasn't a realistic expectation on the person settling that the time bar would be removed, and then a condition was put on that by the insurers that rather than have a decree of dismissal, which would allow it to be raised again, instead, in order to make the settlement and have it agreed, it would be a decree of absolvitor that was imposed when it wasn't actually necessary to have that. Now, we're probably talking about very limited circumstances, but I think it would be disingenuous not to recognise that this clause was put in to cover what may be very, very few cases.
I don't recall that being the circumstance. I dealt with many of those cases at the time. On the contrary, my recollection is that we were somewhat surprised that the claimant solicitor's proposed absolvitor certainly wasn't on the instructions of insurers, as far as those I dealt
with.
That
it could have happened.
I can only speak for the cases I dealt with. And I dealt with, I think, more than any other individual.
Just to clarify as well, Convener, if I heard you correctly, you were suggesting that it was insurers that were proposing this.
As a condition of settlement.
I've got no awareness of that. So if there is documentary evidence that we can see, it would be useful to be able to review that and understand that point in more detail.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly why, in my understanding, that particular section is there, 17C, to cover that precise set of circumstances. So perhaps you might want to go back and look again.
Yes, at that. I'd certainly be very happy to do that.
Okay, why are we, Stuart, sorry.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to drill down a little bit because in your opening remarks, Mr. Watson, you gave us two cases, those that dismissed and those that went to absolvitor. But is it not the case that the absolvitor cases themselves fit into a number of different categories? Those that have gone to proof, issue has been, in terms of evidence, has been resolved and a settlement has been reached. But there are also absolvitors where you're a long way short of that. But also, there are people outside it. And let me just, and this is entirely hypothetical, there are two boys, they're twins. 1970, they are going through exactly the same system, and they are abused, they're together through the system. One goes to the courts and gets a settlement of absolvitor and a payoff, which he accepted at that point as being the best available then. The other twin took no legal action and now
will have the right to go back and will get a potentially a very different outcome, both financially and in terms perhaps of how much of the evidence and the process is dealt with. Is it not, even if we know of no such circumstances as I've described, it is precisely to cover that kind of circumstance that it is proper that when the twin who took no action gets a result, it is proper to revisit and reopen the case that previously someone signed up in the circumstances which were then available, which we now, and I'm getting this from this panel as I did from the previous one, are not the proper way in which we should be dealing with these cases. Is not that the point of principle as to why we set aside the absolvitor in certain circumstances?
Yes, I understand the force of that argument very powerfully. I think it's very clearly made. The issue here is not about the morality of whether these cases should go forward at all, any different from the pre-1964 cases. It cannot be said that there is a moral basis for saying that someone abused in August 1964 cannot come forward, but October 1964
can. Do forgive me. I deliberately, in my example, said 1970 to dispose of the pre-64 issue. No. And I'm not making a moral point, if I may.
What?
I'm making a legal point that the legal circumstances at which the absolvitor was granted to one person in an identical circumstance were likely, under some of the absolvitor circumstances, to have been accepted by the pursuer simply because that was what was then available. And that therefore it is proper, if the law is changed now, to grant an option to pursue a case, that other twin today, that right should be extended to the person who took the absolvitor at that point. That is the legal point. The moral points, I think, we've kind of dealt with. It's a pure legal point. Is that a new thing in law? Is that something that should be utterly resisted in law? In which case, does the whole bill not then fall?
The reason I took it back to 1964 and the question of morality is because the example that you give highlights the challenge precisely because it looks unjust if an individual can proceed in one way and someone else in highly similar circumstances cannot. But phrasing it as you do, as a question of law, is a good way of putting it. And you asked the question of whether this is in effect unique, and the answer is that it is. There is not a precedent for legislating away final determinations, and it's something that has come before the legislature on a number of occasions, not before this legislature but before the Westminster Parliament in the lead up to the 1973 Act and then again in the lead up to its amendment in 1984, and it was very clearly voiced the concerns at interfering retrospectively with rights that had already been determined. And the issue here is one of certainty of law, the rule of law, the importance that that has within Scots law as a system anyway, and then the way in which that is buttressed by the European Convention on Human Rights, and whether looking to reinstate cases that had finally been judicially determined ran counter to both Scots law and the convention.
It's very helpful that you make it in those terms. I think that helps the committee understand the very great care we need to take in dealing with this, but it absolutely reinforces my personal commitment to make sure that we do.
Yeah, and again, going back, I understand entirely what you say. This is a huge issue to get right, but there is a very specific circumstance here where it can be proved that it was a condition of settling and that People did this knowing time bar was in. It was a condition of settling that a decree absolvitor was to be granted, where normally you would expect that to be, in the circumstances, a decree of dismissal. So we're talking about a very narrow issue that's being addressed here. And I don't think there's any attempt, in fairness to the government, the legislation, to overturn the very important principles that you've talked about today. So I hope that's helpful in just closing the discussion on that. Can I get your opinion on that, though? If it is such circumstances which can be proved, would it be fair? Would it be proper? Would it be the right thing to do?
The reason I'm hesitating on that is because, again, I'm coming back to my experience of how these cases were dealt with, and I simply don't recall that they were disposed of
on that basis. If it could be proved that the pursuer, in order to get the settlement, was required by the insurers in settling the case to accept decree of absolvitor, where normally, in the same circumstances, it would have been a decree of dismissal.
There are two circumstances there. One is when there is a payment of money in form of settlement, extrajudicial settlement, as you would get in any form of litigation. It would always be expected that that would be concluded with absolvitor, because that's both parties accepting that they have determined the dispute between them and it is at an end. The other circumstances where a case is abandoned by one party without seeking settlement, and in those circumstances they wouldn't have been receiving anything in return for it, and wouldn't have been, those defending the case wouldn't have been in a position to insist on a decree of absolvitor. Particularly, I mean, the vast bulk of these were legally aided cases. It wasn't like the party defending it was going to get any award of expenses from them anyway.
Insist on it, but because it was a condition of settlement that they put on, and because at that time, because we're not looking at this legislation, the pursuer realised that it was time barred and there was no prospect of it being raised again in any case, then that gave the insurance company that extra, if you like, incentive or leverage for the pursuer to accept absolvitor when it should have been dismissal.
I don't believe that in that circumstance the defender had any leverage, but let me put that to one side and just answer the question directly. My concern about this is that it runs counter to the rule of law and the certainty of law, not the specific circumstances. So in any hypothetical situation, the same would pertain.
That's a helpful discussion. I think there's only one more aspect that we haven't covered, and that was just a double compensation issue, both in terms of where you saw that and the onus on defender or pursuer to establish a settlement.
I was interested in what Mr. Garrett had to say about that and what was in their submission as well. He gave an example of, for instance, a case is settled on behalf of a child by the parent. By definition, that could not have been time barred. So any form of settlement was not on the basis that that there was a limitation issue. By definition, time would not have started running, let alone have run out against a child until they were 19 or 21. What was also striking about that was his concern about the paucity of evidence on the basis upon which a settlement was reached. And I do ask the committee to bear that in mind. We're talking about much more...
double compensation, where it had been settled, compensation had been paid.
Yes, so we're talking about, I think one of his concerns was that it's going to be difficult to establish retrospectively on what basis it was settled, what amount was expenses, what amount was damages, how that decision was reached. And I understand his concern about that, but that goes to highlight the difficulty, the evidential difficulty one faces when trying to investigate what happened years ago. Now, putting that to one side, I can see the force in what he says in an alternative means of addressing this would be to offset whatever was awarded or had been agreed in the context of that earlier settlement. Trying to unpick that as to the basis upon which that was reached is a very difficult exercise. But again, I'm trying to think of situations in which insurers would have said, we'll pay you your expenses plus a nominal sum for damages. There would have been little or no incentive to insurers to do that. I've dealt with approximately 400 to 500 cases. There is none has been in that that situation. So I agree with Mr. Garrett that I'm not clear what ill this is seeking to meet. I agree there's another way of coming at it, but I do encourage the committee to reflect on what he says about evidential difficulties, and those are writ large for the circumstances of abuse itself and are why we have some form of discretion on how these cases proceed.
For us, Mr. Ross, the onus on the defender or the pursuer?
It's a matter of fact. I wouldn't have strong views on where the onus lies. It's the pursuer who's bringing it forward as an aspect of evidence. I would expect in the ordinary run of things the onus to be on the pursuer, but I think that's secondary to the issue of how it's dealt with at all.
Okay. Mr. Ross?
I mean, this seems to be a very specific point because I wasn't aware of this particular double compensation concept being raised in any other evidence the committee's received, and as far as I'm aware, it's not set out in the bill and the supporting documents. And on the one hand, I was very conscious that Graeme Garrett was talking about a hypothetical situation, whereas, you know, as Graeme just said, was it 400 or was it 500 cases you've dealt with? And this hasn't actually been the case in the actuality. So it would be useful to get more information, whether it's from Mr. Garrett or our colleagues or whoever else, on specific examples of this. I can absolutely understand the hypothetical point, but actually specific examples of this. And is it something that's actually happened in the past and we need to be addressing the course of this legislation? Because, you know, from what Graeme said, I'll defer to him in terms of his length of experience in actually handling these cases in court. It's not something that I'm aware of from the insurer side of things. It's not something that I've heard discussed in all the time that I've been working on this bill and in preparation for this meeting. Any kind of indication that there would be this approach where I think it was a token sum of £50, I think it was, he'd suggested. It was something in the region of that. It's just something I've not come across at all, and Graeme wasn't either.
That's been helpful discussion in the round and in that point specifically. Can I thank you both very much for coming? Anything that you want to add in closing, Mr. Roth?
If I may, it's something that hadn't really come up in this session so far, but I do think it's important. I mean, it's the committee's got a significant job here to do. This is a very substantial piece of legislation in terms of its implications, and you know, there's an expectation in the committee to consider all the evidence before it so that you're as well informed as you possibly can be before you make the recommendations at stage one and the bill goes forward.
Mr. Ross.
What I'm struck by and I'm concerned is the fact that you've got fewer than half the number of submissions to your committee that the Scottish Government did when it ran a consultation on this measure in 2015.
And your point being?
I'm just struck by the contrast between the level of evidence that you've received from organisations that have an interest in this bill, and then you look at the likes of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, Lady Smith, at the end of last month, read out a list of literally dozens of organisations that could be affected by this, and yet there doesn't seem to be any representation of their opinions and their voice on the bill when, you know, they could conceivably be affected by it if Lady Smith's inquiry is already investigating allegations of historic child abuse.
Well, no doubt organisations will have noted your point and have the opportunity
I put it on the record, that is all. And yeah, I'm grateful to you for the opportunity to do that.
Okay. But I can assure you that one of the founding principles of this committee is access to justice for all within the criminal justice system. So I hope if you take nothing else away, you take that away today from having heard the questions and the evidence that the committee has received. Thank you for attending. Thank you. We suspend to private session.